Rejoice and be glad in it. That's what the psalmist said. It is so exceptionally good to be once again in the house of the living God. Last week we had a week off and trying to give all the workers an opportunity to be refreshed and be revitalized as it relates to the fifth Sunday. But now we are on the first Sunday and everybody is ready to go. We are excited about once again being able to see each other again, as well as to be in fellowship with one another, and certainly with you. Wherever you are, we want to thank you for joining us this morning. And we certainly do not take your presence for granted, especially during this pandemic. We just want the opportunity for everybody to be able to worship the Lord thy God in the beauty of his holiness. Again, I want to make a special thank you to our AV ministry, Sister Jennifer Baker, Sister Kristen Tennan, Brother Tevin Baker, our audio coordinator, Deacon John Singleton, our conference line coordinator, Dr. Randy Kelly, our musician, the Reverend William Austin, Sister LaShonda Singleton, and we got singers of praise in our choir stand. We got our trustee ministry out there waiting for us, waiting for whatever they need to do. We got you, and you ready for us to be able to bring together an opportunity for us to lift up God in the spirit of his holiness. With that being said, we are going to go ahead and go forward. We're going to have Sister Jewel McMillan to give us our call to worship.
The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. O come, let us sing unto the Lord, who is worthy to be praised.
Let us make the joy of the Lord to the rock of our salvation.
Thank you.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Let all that is within me bless his holy name. He is worthy, my brothers and sisters. He is worthy to be blessed. Amen. Amen. We're now getting ready to have our church covenant, which is for our scriptural reading. And that will be done by Minister George McMillan. And then prayer will be followed by Deacon John Singleton.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We're going to have our church coming to this time. Having been led as we believe by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, we do now in the presence of God, angels, and this assembly most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ.
We engage, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinance, discipline, and doctrine, to contribute cheerfully and directly to the support of the ministry, the expense of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations.
We also engage to maintain family and secret devotions, to religiously educate our children, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances, to walk circumspectly in the world, to be just in our dealing, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger, to abstain from the sale and use of intoxicating drinks as a beverage, and to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior. We further engage to watch over one another in brotherly love, to renew each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy in feeling and courtesy in speech, to be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation, and mindful of the rules of our Savior, to secure it without delay. We moreover engage that when we remove from this place, we will, as soon as possible, unite with some other church where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principle of God's word. And now, unto him who brought again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, be power and glory forever. Amen.
Say good morning.
Good morning.
Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven.
Yes.
Yes,
Lord. Once again, Lord, we just want to talk back and tell you thank you.
Thank you.
Lord, we thank you how you watched over us another week, Lord Jesus.
Yes, yes.
bringing us back and forth down the dangerous highways. On our job, took care of us and brought us back home.
Glory.
We thank you, Mother, for how you woke us up this morning.
Yes.
Touched us with the finger of love, Lord.
Yes.
And we woke up.
Thank you, Jesus.
Eyes came open, Lord, and we said thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Gave us the health and strength to get up out of bed.
Yes.
And put our clothes on this morning to come down to the church one more time.
Yes, yes.
We ask you to continue to bless Hall River in a special way, Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray for our church family, wherever they might be this day.
Yes.
Lord, we ask you to just bless us and anoint us and give
yes,
us, continue to give us that love for each other.
Yes.
What we want to do is help each other, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for our pastor, Lord.
Yeah, bless
him. As he see the vision, and keep us going on, Lord, and
yes,
giving you the honor and the praise.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for how you just brought us and kept us, Lord Jesus.
Yes, our Jesus.
Some is going on home to be with you, Lord.
Yes.
Disease that's going around in the air, Lord, wherever
yes,
might be. But Lord, you're just keeping us here, Lord, and we say thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we ask you to continue to bless us in a special way. That's not only this church. Church is everywhere, Lord.
Yes, yes.
Everybody's going through, Lord. We ask you to just continue to bless us.
Yes.
Let us stand fast, Lord, and just keep believing in you.
Yes.
Everything's going to be all right, Lord. It's all in your hands,
yes,
Lord.
Yes,
put it under you.
Yes.
That's all we can do, Lord. Just put it under you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, believe that everything's going to be all right.
Yes.
And thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
This is our prayer. We ask in Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
To the family of one of our dearest friends and brother in the Lord, the Reverend and Pastor Norman T. Davis. His family is in the period of bereavement, and we are certainly unsure in this totality as to when all services will be done, but from what we hear is that there will be an opportunity for visitation on that of December the 11th, which is next, December the 11th, maybe a walkthrough and viewing that would be at New Hope Missionary Baptist Church, and then there will be a graveside service that will be held at the church cemetery on December the 12th at 11 o'clock a.m. Many of us know him, a very, very powerful man in the ministry, has been around and has tremendously helped out not only the New Hope Association, but has helped out the General Baptist and other churches and in many other cities, not only in North Carolina, but throughout the United States. So again, let us please keep his family in prayer. But in addition, there are other families that are in sickness, those that are in distress. We want to continue to pray for all persons because, my brothers and sisters, we are in a dire time because we are relational. We are relational individuals. God created us for a relationship. Matter of fact, the Bible said that he walked with Adam, talked with him in the cool of the day. And with this pandemic, a lot of us not able to get and to embrace and to reach out as we would want to. So, but please, let's make a concerted effort. If you know of someone that is sick or in distress or in need of even a telephone call them up. I guarantee you that they will be more than happy and excited to be able to hear your voice. Amen. Amen. As it relates to our birthday babies for the month of December, yes, we have Sister Lillian Norman on December the 3rd. December the 7th, we have Dr. Vandy Kelly. December the 8th, we have Brother Michael McMiller Sr. The 17th, Sister Mae Seymour. On the 19th, I have Sister Katrina Farrar. On the 20th, we have Sister Sadie Carson and Sister Janice Price. On the 23rd, we have Sister Catherine Page. On the 28th, Brother Daryl Edwards. On the 29th, Sister LaDonna Jones. And on the 31st, December the 31st, we have Deacon Leroy Kelly, Senior, and Brother Bernard Palmer. A happy birthday to all of our December birthday babies. Amen. Amen. Another announcement is that we are excited. I'm extremely excited to announce that we are in the midst of planning an exceptional Christmas program here at the River. It will be remembered, I guarantee you, for many years to come. And the beauty of this particular program is that everyone, you and you, will have an opportunity to participate. Please call or contact Sister Minister Annette Price at 919-923-0788 as soon as possible so that we can get the show on the road. We're again, it said that we have an opportunity to be able to worship the Lord, and especially the birth of his only begotten son in a way that only the River is able to put it together. So we are hoping that you certainly will be a part of that. Today is Communion Sunday, and in honor of the Lord's commandment found in 1 Corinthians 11th chapter, verse 25, he says, "Do ye this as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me." So as we continue to deal with the announcements and others, please prepare yourselves to do just that immediately after the conclusion of the sermon. That service of communion will be done by Minister Annette Price. Please join us in our regular Sunday school teaching and learning session each Monday night on our conference free line at 7 o'clock p.m. This Monday night's lesson is entitled Call Through Heritage. The focal passage is that of Matthew, the first chapter, verses 1 through 6, and then verses 16 through 17, and then Hebrews, the first chapter, verse 1 through 5. Our teacher this week is none other than Deaconess Laura Singleton. We had an exceptionally good time last week with Minister McMiller and his wife Jewel, and we are excited about what they did. We are just excited and anticipating on what Deaconess Laura Singleton will be doing. Our Bible study this coming Wednesday night, December the 9th, is entitled Curse the Day, Curse the Night.
Why? If you want to know what all that means, join us on this Wednesday night. Job, the third chapter, verses 1 through 10. And in review, you can certainly review chapters 11, 12, and chapter 20. But we will be concentrating more so on the chapter 3. But we're excited about the life of Job and how it applies to us. Finally, my brothers and sisters, it's giving time. Please notice on your screens concerning the tithes and offerings. You may give through Givenify or by sending your check or money order to our address shown on the screen. But we believe that every dime, and you need to understand that every dime that is sent to this church is used for the glory of God. We are excited, certainly, about that. We thank you for your tithe. We thank you for your offering, because God truly has blessed us in many ways, and he certainly wants us to be cheerful givers. Now, I will now ask Trustee Albert Price. He's now ready to come and to do our offertory prayer, which is then going to be followed by our doxology. We thank God for each and every one that is here. And we thank you again for your, certainly for your tithes as well as your offerings.
God, stand, please. Bow your head. Lord Jesus, we humble ourselves before you this morning to glorify and honor you, Lord
Jesus.
Yes. We've been given the test to pray over our offerings.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, for all that you've given us.
Thank you.
We know that everything that we have belongs to you. You only ask us for 10%. And we just ask that you just bless our household, that we're able to just do what your word said. Mm-hmm. We thank you for all that you do, what you're doing now, what you're going to do in the future. We just thank you how we are able to sustain ourselves in this COVID-19 situation,
yeah.
Lord. And we give you all the thanks, all the honor, and all the glory this day, Lord Jesus. Yes. These and all the blessings we ask in your Son, Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Pray, Father, God.
Thank you.
26, verses 25 and verse 26. And about him it reads, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. Mm. And immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bands were loose. Yes. We want to think a few minutes on the thing, God moves at midnight. God moves at midnight. Can we say that together? God moves at midnight. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you are Emmanuel, our God with us. And we know, God, that you love us so much that the Bible said that you gave your son that we may have a right to the tree of life.
Thank you.
And God, it is this gospel of Jesus Christ that is so precious to us today to be able to give me an opportunity to stand once again behind the sacred desk to not only say that I love you,
bless me, Lord,
but to be able to proclaim your word.
Bless Jesus.
Now, Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Yes.
And the men, women, and children of God said, amen.
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 Amen. God moves at midnight. You know, my brothers and sisters, the time of midnight has seemed to fascinate people throughout the ages. It is a time of day that just before the beginning of a new day that seems to get attention from many individuals. Midnight seems to set the adrenaline in our bodies to move. Midnight seems to cause our minds to become more creative. In 1965, at the Lorraine Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee, you may recall this is the same motel in which the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. But in that hotel, there were two men by the names of Wilson Pickett and Steve Crocker. They wrote a song and composed a song entitled In the Midnight Hour. It went something like this. I'm gonna wait till the midnight hour. That's when my love come tumbling back. I'm gonna wait till the midnight hour when there's no one else around. I'm gonna take you, girl, and hold you and do all the things I told you in the midnight hour. Yay, in the midnight hour. My brothers and sisters, people all around the world are excited about that song, that it went on to become the number one on the rhythm and blues chart. In addition, it reached number 134 on the Rolling Stones list of the 500 greatest songs of all time. All because Wilson Pickett capitalized their number on doing something at the midnight hour. For you basketball fans, prior to this pandemic, when the Carolina Tar Heels were ready to make their debut for another basketball season, we are told that thousands upon thousands of excited fans would go to the Dean Dome for a part of what is known as midnight mass. When apartment stores want to attract shoppers to purchase their merchandise, it is not uncommon for those stores to hold what they call a midnight madness sale. We as believers, as Christians, have always known that midnight was a particular time of day for a true worshiper. We are, my brothers, true worshipers. We knew that in the wisdom of God, that he put a special emphasis on midnight. The world may rejoice at midnight because of various activities that persons do. But we as true worshipers and believers know that in the most grave and the most darkest situation, we rejoice because we have a midnight friend. We have a friend who really does not care about the time of day. We have a friend about whom the Bible tells us in Psalms 121 verse 4 that it is a friend who neither slumbers nor sleeps. He is a friend, my brothers and sisters, who is particularly sensitive to our needs at midnight. Jesus conveyed God's commitment and love for us in a parable found in Luke 11 and 5. And it says that, and he said unto them, his disciples, which of you shall have a friend and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. Even though midnight is not the time of day to particularly visit anyone, the Bible tells that his friend gets up. But we are not told that he gets up out of mere friendship, but rather he does so because his friend has the audacity to come and wake him up at midnight. And as such, the Bible tells us that friend that was awake at midnight, that he will rise up and give him as many as he needs. All of us, my brothers and sisters, at some time or another, will come to face with some midnight situation.
Yes.
In our scriptural lesson this morning, the Bible tells us in Acts 16 and 25 that at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. Church, the occasion that the Apostle Paul and Silas were praying was because they were at the end of the rope. You see, the Apostle Paul and Silas were on their second missionary journey to the Gentiles. And while traveling in Macedonia, they came to a city by the name of Philippi. And as they were witnessing and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Apostle Paul, Silas, Luke, as well as Timothy. The Bible tells us that they encountered a damsel, a slave girl, who was possessed by what the Bible tells us was a spirit of divination, a spirit of foretelling. She did so for money because the Bible tells us in that 16th verse of Acts 16 that she brought her master's much gain by soothsaying.
Yeah.
We are told that this slave girl, day after day, followed the Apostle Paul and his company around, constantly crying out and saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And even though the damsel correctly identified these men of God and the purpose of their mission, the spirit of hypocrisy was inside of that slave girl and was just as far from God as the east is from the west, and as far as the north is from the south. And the Apostle Paul knew that spirit in the slave girl did not mean them any good. But yet, in spite of the knowledge, the Bible tells us that the Apostle Paul tried to not to lose focus and the purpose of his mission. So he kept on doing what he kept doing because he was following his own words found in Romans 12:18 that says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, we need to live peaceably with every man. But yet, day after day, as this slave girl continued to follow the missionaries around, constantly hearing her condescending word of these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show us the way to salvation. The Apostle Paul's frustration with her began to reach a boiling point.
Right.
My brothers and sisters, whether we believe it or not, we must be on God, the truth found in Matthew 7:21, that says that not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of God.
Right.
It is very clear, my brothers and sisters, that the slave girl was not on God's side. And the spirit in her not only was objective, not only to impede the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the word of God, and to the citizens at Philippi. Everything in her wanted them to make certain that they would not be able to get the word. But there comes a time, my brothers and sisters, in our lives that whether we want to or not, that we must confront demonic spirits and call them for who they are. This is exactly what the Apostle Paul did. For the Bible tells us in that 18th verse that Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the spirit, "I command thee in the name of Jesus to come out of her." And the Bible said that spirit came out that very same hour. My brothers and sisters, I was reading an article in Newsweek magazine some almost 8 years ago now. I discovered that there came across a new word. That new word was Christophobia. Now, I know that's not a good word that many of us really try our best to find, but it is a real word. Because the word Christophobia has been defined as meaning an intolerance and a hostility toward or a discrimination against Christians. It was initially a word that was used by a writer in 2012, which described a seemingly an all-out attack on Christians. And according to that article, terrorist attack on Christians had escalated in Africa, in the Middle East, as well as in Asia. And it had increased by some 309% between the years 2003 and 2010. Those attacks range from the passing of blasphemy laws to brutal murders, to bombing and to mutilation, as well as the burning of holy sites. And though the article was written in 2012, we are reading about that now we are reading about this damsel. This damsel is using demonic means of the fortune teller to promote the gospel of Jesus Christ, and what she did not believe. We don't have to go to Africa, my brothers. We don't have to go to the Middle East or to Asia to find persons who are Christophobic. Yeah. There are demon-possessed people all around us right now. They are trying to impede the spread of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yeah. Yeah. They hate the word of God. They hate the men of God. They hate the women of God. And they have launched an all-out war. Yeah. And doing this, they're doing everything in their power to keep the word of God from going forth to create new creatures. But just like the Apostle Paul, we just need to hold on, and we need to hold out. And when we as Christians get fed up with Christophobic persons, we will call on the name of the Lord. Right? And just like God silenced the damsel when Paul called on the name of Jesus, God will silence those who come up against us. Now let me remind you, my brothers and sisters, and by the scriptural lesson this morning, that just as when God silenced the damsel, it does not mean that we will still not be under some kind of satanic attack. And that's exactly what happened to the Apostle Paul and Peter and Silas. For the Bible tells us that the owner of the damsel became enraged because their source of money had been taken away. And therefore, the Bible tells us in verses 19 through and 20, 21, that they caught Paul, they caught Silas, and threw them into the marketplace in front of the rulers. And they brought them to the magistrate, saying, "These men, being Jews, doing stuff exceedingly trouble our city. They teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans." And after the charges were told, the Bible says to us that the magistrates tore their clothes and commanded that the Apostle Paul and Silas be beaten. But unlike Jewish beaten with only 39 stripes. Under Roman law, prisoners could be beaten unmercifully. So in that 23rd verse, we find that after they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safe. And prior to my continuing on, the question comes up that only the Apostle Paul and Silas were arrested. But I told you earlier that on this missionary journey, there were at least four individuals.
Right.
Yes, the Apostle Paul, Silas, Luke, as well as Timothy. If all of the missionaries were doing the same thing, again, Paul, Silas, Luke, and Timothy, and they were proclaiming the word of God to the citizens at Philippi, why is it that only the Apostle Paul and Silas were the only ones arrested, not only arrested, but beaten and thrown into jail? Well, the answer is that these men, being Jews, in that 20th verse, Luke and Timothy were not arrested because they were not of Jewish descent. They were Gentiles, and then Timothy was that of Greek heritage. Only Paul and Silas were Jews.
Right.
And because the owners assumed that Paul and Silas were not Roman citizens, they could treat Paul and Silas any way they had felt fit. So you see, my brothers and sisters, in the Roman Empire, there were two sets of law. One for the citizens of Rome and another for the non-citizens. The rights of Roman citizens were highly protected. Non-Roman citizens had no right. Non-Roman citizens were subject to both the whims and of the multitude of people as well as the Roman magistrates. But in addition, the Romans were especially prejudiced against the Jews, whom they thought were always trying to peddle their religion on them. So therefore, when arriving at Philippi, the Apostle Paul and Silas already had two strikes against them. Both of them were of Jewish heritage, and though both of them were Roman citizens, their Roman citizenship was not known. So therefore, in addition to being angry because of the loss of their income, the owners were also racially motivated toward Paul and Silas being Jews. My Christian friends, I know we're talking about Paul and Silas, but oh how the racial overtones of this particular passage bring back memories. It reminds me of the many times that the civil liberties of our African Americans have been violated. I have memories of the civil rights struggle here in the United States and how there was one set of laws for white Americans and another set of laws for African Americans. And just like the Apostle Paul and Silas, who being of Jewish heritage were beaten unmercifully and thrown in Roman jail, while only exercising their right to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. I remember when hundreds and hundreds of African Americans were beaten and held by police, those who had sworn to protect them, who dogs bit them and threw us in jail, all because we were trying to receive equal pay or to have an equal education or to sit and eat in restaurants or simply just to sit on the front of the bus. But don't let the American dream that many of our African Americans have achieved. We may appreciate them, but let us not be fooled by the smiling faces and the slaps on our back. The rights of many African Americans are still constantly being violated. We are being violated, my brothers and sisters, not because of the breaking of any particular law, but because of the color of our skin. Violations such as driving while black, walking while black, bird watching while black. My brothers and sisters, don't we live in a society, we are still judged by the color of our skin.
Yes, sir, come on.
And I am tremendously thankful that we serve a God who is not my brothers and sisters. We serve a God who loves everybody. And I'm excited about that. And if it wasn't enough of being God dealing with that, we are still in the midst of a war. First of all, we are here in the United States. We are in not only, we are in the throes of a worldwide pandemic called COVID-19. It is a merciless virus that continues to attack our physical body. We're in worldwide from 1.59 million individuals have already died. And just in the United States alone, more than 12,000 deaths are being added to this already alarming number daily. My brothers and sisters, we are at war. We are at war. At war of more than trying. On the surface, it may seem like the war is centralized in the White House between the president and the president-elect. It may on the surface appear that it is confined to Congress between the Republicans and the Democrats. And as I stand before you, just like this passage of scripture, we as a nation are in the throes of a spiritual warfare. My brothers and sisters, not because of any flesh and blood, but in the words of the Apostle Paul, the war that I'm thinking of and referring to, is that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against power, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness. And
yeah.
Thank you. Don't you let nobody have a fool. We said, God, yeah. Don't you let nobody turn you around, turn you around, turn you around. Don't you let nobody turn you around. Hey, and then look to Calvary, my brother.
Yes, sir.
You got it. Yeah. Because it's Calvary that gives us the answer to our problems. Yeah. You don't see him there. Because he's not there. Because he's already been there. He has done what he said he promised.
Yes, he did.
He has done.
Yes, he did.
As we continue in our worship service, I'm telling you, God moves.
Yes.
Heaven and earth.
Yes.
He is a God who serves
in it.
To be able to help us in any situation in our life. If you don't know him, you're missing out on the food. If you don't know him, you're missing out on the blessing. If you don't know him, you're just missing out on the blessing. He is a God who moves in the middle. But there may be someone out there today who does not accept Christ as your Savior. So if you have not accepted Christ as your Savior, God wants to move. He wants to move on your behalf. He's already moved to make preparations for you to come to him just as you are.
Yeah.
If you're trying to clean yourself up, you're going to be like a lost ball in high weeds. You're not going to be able to do it. God has already found you.
Yeah.
He has already made preparations for you to be found, for you to be saved.
Yeah.
All you got to do is believe in your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and that God raised him from the dead. And the Bible said, you shall be saved.
Yes.
You shall be saved. My brothers and sisters, I am excited what God is doing. Let us pray for this prayer. Heavenly Father, Heavenly Father, I pray all out there right now that have heard this message. God, I pray that they will examine their own spirit. And I pray that they will say the word, Lord, I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus. And I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. And God, I believe what you say. You say, I shall be saved. And God, by the power of you in me, I proclaim that everyone who did just that, they are saved, they are saved, they are saved. Now, Father God, I ask that you pour out your anointing afresh for everyone who's willing to receive you, that they may be able to see you more clearly and to love you more dearly. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now, my brothers and sisters, getting ready to go into our service of communion. The minister, that Christ is going to lead us. Again, I will not be back. She's also going to be doing the benediction. But I just want to thank each one of you for just being so wonderful. And I noticed you all may not have seen Trustee Price wiping as he did, but you saw him waving his hand. He has an instrument that sanitizes everything that we touch. And I'm excited about that. God is providing.
Yes.
If we just let him provide, God will do just what
he
said.
Yes, he will.
Do.
Yes, he will.
He is a God.
Yeah, I believe.
Who moves at me. Wonderful, wonderful.
Yeah, hallelujah.
the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Give God some praise. Amen. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
At this time, we will have our communion service, and I hope that you at home are prepared with your elements. And will join us this morning, this afternoon. Amen. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. 1 John 1:8 tells us these words. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Let us therefore humbly confess our sins to God and seek his forgiveness through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Almighty and most merciful God.
Almighty and most merciful God.
We acknowledge and confess.
We acknowledge and confess.
That we have sinned against you.
That we have sinned against you.
In thought, word, and deed.
In thought, word, and deed.
We have not loved you.
We have not loved you.
All our heart,
with all our heart,
soul, mind, and strength,
soul, mind, and strength,
and we have not
loved our neighbors
as ourselves.
Forgive us, O God,
for what we have been,
and help us to become
what we ought.
Let us love one another.
Let love fill our lives. So that we
may give of ourselves.
To you.
Even as Christ.
Has given of himself.
For us.
This is our prayer. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
At this time we will have scripture by Minister George McDowell.
Corinthians, the 11th chapter reads in the 23rd verse, for I have received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. And said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup.
Beloved, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. All who believe in Jesus and all who are in love and fellowship with the saints are invited at this time to partake for the supper of the Lord. At this time, we'll have prayer by Reverend William Austin.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord, for coming to the world.
Yes.
And dying for our sin.
Yes, Lord.
That we may have a right to the tree of life.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for earth's saddest day.
Yeah.
And earth's gladdest day.
Yes.
We know it was a sad and a glad day. But we thank you, Lord, for the sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have to make that sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
We thank you, Lord, for the bread which represents your body. Oh, God, help us, Lord, as we take it. And just think about you sacrificed the body.
Yes.
They pierced you in your side.
Mm-hmm.
And out came blood and water.
Mm-hmm.
And as we take up the cup, bless the cup, as we remember, Lord, the blood, the shedding of your blood, came that we might have this free salvation. You paid for it. And we thank you for it.
Thank you, Lord.
And we're going to trust you and remember you always.
Yes.
Remember this great day in our lives that we can have joy.
Yes.
Because of the blood, we can have peace. We can have healing. Anything that we need. We can get it through your blood.
Yes, sir.
Thank you right now for this opportunity to remember you once again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Let us now eat together. Jesus said, "This cup is a New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us now drink together. Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you for another opportunity. We thank you, God, for allowing us to come in your presence for communion, to commune with you, Lord.
Yes.
All these we did in remembrance of you, Lord. God, we thank you for your forgiveness.
Lord, I know you did.
We thank you for your grace. And God, we thank you for your mercy.
Yes.
This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Now, if all minds and hearts are clear, if you will all stand. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. This is our prayer. Amen. Let the church say amen.